Last we have Alexandra Kosiba. Alexandra is a PhD student here at UVM, Dr. Schauber and Nader. She studies how trees in the northeastern U.S. are responding to changes in the climate. And her talk is using dendroecological techniques to interpret the response of trees to environmental change at BMC's Mount Mansfield study site.
Changes in our region, and the predictions are that those changes will increase. And we've seen changes in tree physiology and vigor. We've seen growth declines, decreases in vigor, and increased mortality for some species in recent decades. Widespread and well-documented declines in both red spruce and sugar maple have been attributed to acid deposition and resulting calcium decline. Depletion. But at the same time, other species in our region appear to be healthy and stable, perhaps have had periods of limited decline, or there's insufficient data for us to really make projections on trends. At the same time, there are some indication, as Shelley showed my data for my master's work, that some species might be experiencing novel growth increases. So, for example, red spruce. And this is all on the backdrop of increasing changes in our climate, as well as decades of acid deposition and land use changes that have occurred over decades and centuries. So the goal for this project was to assess recent patterns and trends in forest growth for five key tree species on Mount Mansfield. And the data that I'm presenting here is really a small portion of what we did. I cannot put this into 10 minutes. So hopefully that report will be on the web soon. But we looked at sugar maple, red maple, yellow birch, red spruce, and balsam fir. And to do this, we set up three transects on Mount Mansfield. Can I have a laser pointer? Yes, I do. You can see this is forehead and chin of Mansfield. And we set up transected Browns River, Stevensville Brook, and Ranch Brook watersheds. And we did not put one in the Stowe ski resort area for obvious anthropogenic disturbances that occurred there. At each one of these transects, we then selected plots at three different elevations. And at low elevation, we sampled red maple, sugar maple, and red spruce. At mid elevations, yellow birch, sugar maple, and red spruce. And at high elevations, we sampled balsam fir and red spruce. And for each of these species at each plot, we sampled at least 12 dominant, co-dominant trees. So we ended up with 265 trees for this study, and we followed standard dendrochronological techniques. We then converted the linear growth measurements into an area basis called basal area increment, or BAI. And to compare more easily between species, we standardized this BAI into a Z-score. And we actually did a number of other methods here, including some FIA understory plots and vigor and crown health assessments. But again, I don't have time to present that data. Oh, and I should mention that the standardized Z-score is based on a mean and standard deviation for that species at that plot. And I'll be presenting data just from a limited time frame, which is 1980 to 2012 here. So the first of these results are is for sugar maple at low elevation. And this is the Z-score here. So you can see 0 is indicated with this dark line. And that indicates mean growth for this time period, 1980 to 2012. Negative values indicate the growth was below that mean, and positive values growth was above that mean. So it's a nice, easy way to visualize growth changes over time. You can see for sugar maple here, growth fluctuates around the mean. A lot of these dips in growth actually do align with known biotic and abiotic factors. Sugar maple in particular seem to be very affected by a number of factors on the landscape. For example, this is likely the late spring frost we had in 2010. And you can see at the end of the chronology here, growth is below the mean. For red maple, we saw a little bit of a different pattern with growth beginning below the mean for this time period, fluctuating. But then the really surprising thing was this growth increase at the end of the chronology in 2012. And we saw that at all three red maple plots, which was a surprise to us. For red spruce, the trend for low elevation red spruce was to begin with growth below the mean, which is understandable considering winter injury that occurred here in acid deposition. Many of the dips in growth for red spruce align with known winter injury events in the region. And as Shelley pointed out in her talk, this increase in red spruce was really striking. We saw in the last few years of the chronology. And we sampled red spruce at all nine plots, and we saw this growth increase at all nine plots. At mid-elevation, sugar maple seemed to be doing better in relative growth than those at low elevation. They fluctuate above and below the mean, but generally hover around the mean. Yellow birch at mid-elevation also showed pretty stable growth over time, although you can see a lot of variability between the transects, which is indicated by these large standard error bars. We're not really exactly sure why that is, but it might mean that yellow birch is more influenced by local site factors than more broad scale factors with growth. For red spruce at mid-elevation, growth begins below the mean, dips a little bit above and below, but again, you'll see this strong increase in growth, relative growth at the end of the chronology. At high elevation, we only sampled balsam fir and red spruce, which is two species. You can see that balsam fir doesn't have a lot of fluctuations in growth compared to the other species, and generally ends the chronology with growth below the mean. And this is really striking when you compare it to red spruce growth that began with its growth in the 80s below the mean due to acid deposition likely. And then in this last decade or so is far surpassing the relative growth rate of balsam fir. We were then interested to see in the 5 years prior to sampling, so 2008 to 2012, what's the average standardized growth for these species. And for red spruce, their growth in those 5 years prior to sampling was significantly greater than balsam fir, sugar maple, and yellow birch, indicated by the different letters here. And for red maple, this was significant. Their growth was significantly greater than balsam fir and sugar maple. We then wanted to look at if that standardized growth was different from a mean of zero, which would mean that positive values would mean that growth in the last 5 years was significantly higher than the 32-year average. And for red spruce and red maple, that was true. So the growth in the last 5 years significantly greater than that entire chronology to 1980, while for sugar maple, it was significantly less. We also were interested to see how this chronology from Mount Mansfield compared to the broader region. And this is depicting our red spruce chronology from Mount Mansfield in red here, overlaid with a chronology from over 450 red spruce trees from a variety of sites. I think it's up to 40 sites now in New Hampshire, Vermont, and northwestern Massachusetts. And you can see that the alignment of these two chronologies is quite strong, with an R squared of 0.84. I was pretty impressed and surprised with this alignment. And this indicates that likely red spruce is responding well to broad scale factors. The time period of most divergence here is about the 80s to the early 2000s, and that was also a period interspersed with a lot of winter injury events. So perhaps this indicates that red spruce on Mount Mansfield were injured on average less than those in the region. But you can see this increase in growth for both chronologies at the end of the chronology in recent years. And again, this synchrony in response indicates that it's likely a region-wide phenomenon affecting the growth and not local site disturbance factors. We then compared our sugar maple chronology to a chronology in the Hubbard River Experimental Forest. And you can see the alignment is not as strong. And this is not a region-wide chronology. This is just from one location in New Hampshire. But the alignment is still good. They have an agreement here. And especially after 1980, the chronologies do not differ in any one year significantly. And this 1982 really aligns with the period when sugar maple decline was being first noticed, and acid deposition and calcium depletion were affecting sugar maple throughout the region. The yellow birch chronology does not align very well with our Hubbard River chronology. This is not that many trees. We only sampled yellow birch at mid-elevations, so that could likely be one of the factors at play. Again, we're comparing two distinct sites. And yellow birch seems to be dominated by local site factors based on the large standard error bars around the mean. So from this short amount of data that I'm presenting here, some interesting facts we found is that the timing of maximum growth for these species really differed. I didn't show the entire chronology, but for sugar maple and yellow birch, the peak in growth was in the 60s and 80s, while for red spruce and red maple is much more recent. Balsam fir had no discernible peak in growth. And compared to species-specific means in the past 5 years, both red spruce and red maple have shown increases in growth. Balsam fir and yellow birch are around average, and sugar maple has growth that is less than that 32-year mean. And indeed, red spruce has had the highest growth in recent years for over 100 years in a chronology. And this does indicate this could be a region-wide phenomenon. And I think what was interesting is that our comparisons of growth at Mansfield did align well, especially when we had a lot of replication, like for red spruce with other locations. And that shows that perhaps about Mansfield is representative of the region as a whole. And with that, I would like to thank people that have helped with this research and the Vermont Monitoring Cooperative for funding it.
Any speculation on what's going on with the red spruce, why it's thriving something?
Oh, that's part of my dissertation research, but yeah, I think I'm hypothesizing that it's changes in climate. I think perhaps a late season. Red spruce can photosynthesize in the kind of dormant season. You know, it can come out of dormancy much easier than other species, and if the fact it has needles year round, I think could benefit it. Increased temperature, the potential possibility, as Jen alluded to, some pollution signal with increased nitrogen deposition as well. So we'll see. I'll let you know.
So that's tree growth.
Yeah.
Is there stand growth for any of that same general areas or same plots or anything like that? Because I could imagine if just say all the suppressed trees just all of them, they all died for some reason, right? Mm-hmm. Then you'd get increased tree growth, but your stand growth wouldn't be any better.
Right. Well, that's true. One of the reasons we pick dominant, codominant trees, so they're less likely to be influenced by competition and stand dynamics. I did do FIA understory plots, and I didn't include that data here. But one of the parts of this project I didn't mention is that these nine plots are now set up as permanent plots, too, so that we can monitor those changes into the future. We have now tree cores. We can collect other, you know, additional data to add to those analyses.
I'm just curious, we're seeing a really big signal on the national forest in terms of red spruce regeneration, seedlings and saplings, just really big flushes and lots of, and we're attributing it to recovery from land use history. And I'm wondering how much of that signal, like species moving from, you know, immature into mature, and from, you know, not codominant to codominant positions, like how much of that signal is being picked up, or do you think this is a different thing?
I do think that, I definitely know that that's true too, and I think a lot of people who are in the forests have noticed that there is a lot of red spruce regeneration in the northern hardwood forest. And I do think that's, you know, that's been one of the things we're constantly looking at. Is this, you know, is this from land use history? Is this a disturbance signal? But that's the power of dendroecology, is taking, you know, many trees at a site, at least, you know, 12 to 15, if not more, and it's replicated around a region, if you can pick up the same signal. And that's one of the ways that researchers determined that there was an acid rain signal in the 70s and 80s, to see this, you know, decline at a large scale. If we're seeing this increase at a large scale, it likely indicates that there's something else to play. But that is something we're constantly, it's a problem with doing this in the, you know, Northeast. You have so many factors, you have acid rain, disturbance, you know, you name it. So I'm not quite sure how to tease that all apart.